Worship today. It's good to see everyone in the Lord's house on this beautiful Lord's Day. I'd also like to take a moment to welcome those viewing the via the web stream, and we ask God's blessings to be with you all as well. I do want to issue an apology in the event that we do lose our web stream today. We've had some issues with Spectrum Internet in the last several days. Right now, it's holding out pretty good. If it should drop you during the service, we will have the recording of that uploaded a little bit later this afternoon so you can go back and continue to watch the worship service. Now, within your bulletin, I almost want to call it a magazine today. There's a lot of great information, a lot of inserts here. So from your actual bulletin itself, I'll get to the inserts in just a moment. Keep in mind that today, and this does relate to one of the inserts, is the deadline for the Circle for Christ Father's Day fundraiser. For $1 per listing, either in honor or memory of a father, grandfather, father figure, you can have their name included in a special insert next Sunday on Father's Day. But today is the deadline for those forms. You'll find the envelope and the forms there in your bulletin. Now, tomorrow night, there are circle meetings, but Circle for Christ, it is meeting at Cracker Barrel, but not at 7 o'clock. That meeting will take place at 6 o'clock tomorrow evening for Circle for Christ at Cracker Barrel. We also have Board of Trustees and Trinity Circle tomorrow evening. Make note of our Wednesday schedule. Next weekend, next Friday and Saturday, going to be very busy over in Heritage Hall as we participate in this year's 301 Endless Yard Sale. That goes from 7 a.m. to 5 p.m. each of those 2 days. I've been informed if you go over and you do any pre-shopping, please don't take anything just yet. If you find something over there that you like, if you would put it to the side, put your name on it, and claim it, we'll work out you paying it and getting ready to take it home. But please, they're trying to get everything priced and organized for next weekend. So if there's something you really like and you must have, set it aside, put your name on it, and we'll make sure that you get that once everything is said and done. Now for the inserts. There are two inserts related to summer adventures. The truth is, only one of those really is summer adventures. The color insert. This is senior adventures. It may say summer adventures at the top, but it is actually senior adventures, and that is concerning a couple of outings that are taking place. One on Saturday the 25th in 2 weeks, and then another that's coming up in mid-July. So if you're a part of our Senior Adventures group, maybe you haven't been with the Senior Adventures, I'll tell you, they have a great time, and what happens on the trip stays on the trip, so please mark your calendars for those upcoming events. It's all good Christian fun, I'll go ahead and say that. Now the other one that's black and white that says Summer Adventures has the summer adventure schedule for our young people. That begins the Wednesday following Vacation Bible School in July. And on the reverse side of that, you have the dates for Vacation Bible School, as well as information related to the Carolina Mudcats game that we'll be going to in support of the original Free Will Baptist Children's Home. I promise I'm almost finished. You have an insert related to today's message. It has notes on one side, the sermon text on the other, so that you can follow along during that point in our worship service. There is an insert related to June being National Safety Month, and it has some thoughts and some statistics information there related to safety, especially when we're here together at the church. And in honor of National Safety Month, there is a little form, a little ticket very similar to this one located in the conference room as well as the narthex, and there are some questions there as far as locating the first aid kits and also our AED in the event of an emergency. If you will fill out that little form and drop it into one of the baskets, you will be eligible to win a car. First aid kit, that is. A car first aid kit. So please do that and support this special occasion, and definitely that's being put out by our emergency response team. We certainly hope there are no emergencies when we are together as a church. Anything is possible, and we want to make sure that we are ready.
Okay. Just to give a little bit more information on youth-involved activities, we need volunteers. I'm always asking for volunteers, aren't I? The yard sale is going to be a big event. Those are some long hours. The Christian Education Board can't do it alone. We especially are encouraging parents of any of our children and youth to help, because this money does go to our Children and Youth Fund to help fund any of our children and youth activities that we have throughout the year, especially our camp, and it helps with the summer adventures, it helps with after school program, it helps with when we go to the Mudcats game, it helps when we go various places throughout the year. So any of our parents who can help, grandparents, anyone who can help, if you just love our youth and would like to continue to see us have youth, we would appreciate help with the yard sale. So if you can help anytime with the yard sale, we appreciate that. We do still have some furniture that needs to be moved this week. We still have some pricing that needs to be done. So if you can let us know, please let us know. We need additional volunteers for Bible school. So if you can help, we need some people who can lead groups around. We're going to need some help with registration and some different areas, so leading games and different things, so please let us know for that. There is a blurb about the Mudcats game. That will be the Friday night after Bible school. I did not plan it that way. It just happened to fall that way. That is open to anyone who would like to go. The children and youth who would like to go are free, but if they're in third grade or younger, they have to have a parent attend with them. But we will need transportation for kids, so please keep that in mind. And summer adventures, the one again that's black and white. We will need van drivers and we will need adult help with that. So if you are able to help with that, note those four dates, July and August, that we will be doing that, and please let me know if you are able to help with that. I think that's it. Let us prepare our hearts for worship. Stand and join us in the responsive call to worship. Day after day, an abundance of God's love.
Morning by morning, new signs of blessing.
A gentle rain, an awesome sunset.
A friend's embrace, a child's smile.
A new insight, a sense of peace.
A shared meal, a treasured moment.
All around us and deep within us are signs of God's presence.
How can we not sing of God's faithfulness?
Our song of celebration is page 43, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Thank you.
know y'all are excited getting to know each other again. Our epistle lesson comes from Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 5. Romans 5, 1 through 5. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be unto God.
As we go to our Heavenly Father in prayer this morning, brothers and sisters, I call your attention to the back portion of the bulletin. You'll see many names reflected there within our church family and extended community. Are there other names that you would have us to lift up this morning? Megan Meredith. Okay, as she has surgery. Anyone else? Debbie Baker, she had surgery. Yes, those who were injured during the fire this past Friday in Lenoir County, the controlled burn and the explosion and everything that took place, the family that lost a loved one and those who are still injured. Perhaps by uplifted hands. God sees each and every heart, and God understands the depths of our needs. Would you bow with me for a time of prayer? Lord, your Spirit is nothing less than a gift. A gift that you promised long ago and that you fulfilled on that day of Pentecost, and that you continue to fill us with each and every day. Lord, it's tough to live this life of faith, but your word bears witness that the Spirit will show us what we need to do and let us know what we need to say and when. And to give us comfort and encouragement for the living of times such as these. Lord, we thank you for the precious gift of that comforter, the advocate, the Holy Spirit, who abides with us daily, equipping us as we seek to be a people of faith everywhere that we go, giving us the words to speak and the actions which embody the kingdom of God. Lord, we thank you for life's blessings, and we know that we are truly indebted to you because you lavish grace upon grace in our lives each and every day. We could go around this assembly today and lose track of time as we stop to count our blessings. But time will not allow for that because, Lord, we know we are blessed beyond measure, beyond what we even deserve. Lord, as we come together today, not only do we celebrate life's blessings, we also remember so many who are hurting. The needs of our hearts today are many, and not just physical, but spiritual, mental, even emotional in nature. We know there are so many people hurting today in a multitude of ways. We think of those who have had surgeries, those who are preparing for procedures. We remember those impacted by the fire in LaGrange this past Friday. Lord, we think, as Patrick reminded us, of so many circumstances around our world where violence and brokenness are characteristic. Lord, we think of the times in which we live where gas prices and groceries are getting more and more expensive by the day. Lord, it's moments like this that could lead us into depression, anxiety, worry. But Lord, we know that you are with us during these times to give us the strength to see us through uncertainty. Lord, I ask that you would hear the prayers of your people this day, even those that are beyond human words and understanding. Lord, we're thankful for the Holy Spirit, as Romans 8 says, who intercedes for us even when we don't know what or how to pray. Now, Lord, continue with us in this season of worship. Guide and direct us to be open and receptive to the things of your holy word. And when we leave this place of worship, may we be eager to go out and say, Lord, I haven't simply been to church, but now, Lord, let me be the church. This prayer we lift up in your Son's most precious and holy name.
please stand and join me in the affirmation of faith. Let it begin. We believe there is one living, true, and eternal God, the Father, in whom are all things, from everlasting to everlasting, glorious and unchangeable in all his attributes. We believe there is one Lord, Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, the only Son of God, born of the Virgin Mary, who is truly God and truly human. We believe there is one Holy Spirit, the precious gift of the Father through his Son, who is the divine presence in our lives. We believe that the church is the body of Christ, all believers everywhere. We believe in the general provision made of God in Christ for all who respond in total trust and commitment. We believe in the fellowship of the saints through the worshiping community and in the promise of life eternal. Amen. You may be seated, and the children may come with me to Junior Church.
Sermon text for today is taken from this week's Psalter lesson. It's found in Psalm 8. Psalm 8, one of the most popular of the Psalms, maybe not as much as 23 or 100 or 121, but one that once you begin to hear its words, it starts to resonate with your heart and soul. Psalm 8. May we give ear to the reading of Holy Scripture. O Lord, our Sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouths of babes and infants, you have founded a defense because of your foes, to silence both the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and stars that you have established, what are human beings that you are mindful of them, mortals that you should care for them? Yet you made them a little lower than God and crowned them with glory and honor. You've given them dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under their feet. All sheep and oxen, and also the beast of the field, the birds of the air and the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the paths of the sea. O Lord, our Sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Brothers and sisters, may God add a blessing to this reading, hearing, understanding, and living of these words for our days. Amen. We believe in God, the Father Almighty. We believe there is one living, true, and eternal God. We believe there is God. These words and many like them form what we call week after week affirmations of faith within our worship services. Now, for some people, an affirmation of faith may be filler for the worship hour. It may be just something to engage the congregation within the time of worship, to give you all something to say or read. But when you think about it, the affirmation of faith is so much more than that. when we pause and we reflect line by line and word by word on what those affirmations of faith are saying, we discover the fundamentals of who we are as Christians. Some of those affirmations may be the same in one church week after week after week because they're designated for that particular denomination. You may hear the Apostles' Creed or the Nicene Creed, or today in worship we shared the original Free Will Baptist Creed. What does that word mean to you, creed? For some, it can be just a rote tendency, something to say, something to repeat because, well, the preacher wants us to do that. And if we're not careful, and if we're totally honest as Christians, sometimes some of what we do and say within the context of worship can be mere habit. And maybe not even in the context of worship. Sometimes what we do and what we're about as the people of God can become habit. Now, habits don't have to be bad things, but sometimes we don't really know why we do what we do. We just know that we do it. It's a lot like the woman who cut the end off of her ham before cooking it. Why did she do so? Because her mother did so, and the mother did so because the grandmother did so. When one asked the grandmother, why did she do such a thing? She responded, well, I don't know why my daughter and granddaughter do it. I do it because my pan wasn't big enough. How Christianity can be at times as well, can it? We go through the motions, we say things, we do things, we act, we stand up, we sit down, we show up, we go home because it seems like the thing to do. But when we think about what we believe, should it be as pure and simple as that? We believe because the preacher told me to believe. Or, I believe because my parents and grandparents brought me along in the faith tradition. We all have reasons for why we believe the things that we believe, but many of us don't take the time to think about them, especially when it comes to matters of faith. And that's the journey that we're going to take through these Sundays of the summer in a series that's entitled Creed. That word comes from the Latin credo, which means to believe. The statements of our faith are nothing new. Some may read a little bit more modern as far as the language is concerned, but many of them originated just a few hundred years after the life of Jesus Christ, as church members tried to make sense of their beliefs and tried to articulate their core values and beliefs in a pagan world. They tried to narrow down the essentials, the fundamentals that we call them of the faith. What is correct Christian teaching and doctrine, and what is it that is on the fringes of Christianity? What is it that we might consider heretical? And so for many years in the early church, there were things called church councils that would be called in order that people like us might sit down and discuss matters of faith and doctrine and teaching. And it was from that that Christians began to lay down what's most important, what really matters at the end of the day. Now, some of us may not think that what we believe as Christians is all that important. I've heard some people say that, well, as long as you believe something, that's all that matters. Or as long as you're sincere with what you believe, that's what really counts. But if you think about it, when it comes to that word believe or belief, we all have them. And why it's so important for us to think about what it is that we believe, especially as Christians, is because, as with any other facet of life, our beliefs shape our convictions. And then our convictions shape our attitudes. And ultimately, our attitudes shape our lives, our actions. If it's important to think about what we believe for life in general, then how much more so when it comes to who we are and who we're becoming in Christ? We say these things week after week. We can talk the church language. We read the scripture. We know all of these things in and out, or so we think. But when is the last time that any of us really sat down to think about what we believe and why we believe it? And if it's so important to us, how is that changing who we are and who we're becoming each and every day in Christ? I never really thought about this until I was a student at Mount Olive College, now the University of Mount Olive, and one of the first classes I took in the fall of 2002 was entitled Systematic Theology with the Reverend Dr. David Hines. Systematic Theology is a class that basically looks at the key doctrines of who we are as Christians. It starts out with the belief in God and Jesus and the Holy Spirit. It looks at salvation and how we believe as Christians that salvation functions in our lives. We talked about what the church is and how the church is to live in the world. And ultimately, we talked about the end of all things, the consummation of the world, the times. It was a challenging class because I was new to the religion department, and so much of what I knew and thought and believed about my faith had been instilled through my parents and grandparents and Sunday school teachers and preachers, and if they said it, well, it must be the gospel truth. But over the course of those 16 weeks, my professor really challenged me to think about what all of this means and why it's even important. There's so many people in our world today that would say, God, who's that? If there's a God, who really cares one way or the other, because the world's going to pot as we know it. I remember when I was going to that class and beginning those ministerial studies, I had another original Free Will Baptist minister tell me, Brother Kelly, don't let them change you. If you start to become too smart for your own good, I will call you out. I will let you know if you're becoming something that you're really not. I understood what he meant. Don't go off to college to be equipped for ministry and lose your faith because of your smarts. I got that. I believe he was sincere, but then at the same time, that's not what happened. And I don't say that in an arrogant, conceited kind of way. I have never gone back to this gentleman and said, I proved you wrong. If anything, that semester in systematic theology taught me to appreciate my faith. It deepened my commitments on a lot of things. It taught me humility about my beliefs and my values as a Christian. But I'll tell you what it did ultimately, is it taught me that faith and life have to operate together. It's not a matter of faith and life. It's a matter of faith shaping my life, my understanding of God and salvation and creation, who I am as a human being, how all of this fits together, and why it makes a difference in our world today. When we think about the words of the psalmist, we find him doing a little bit of theology, we might say. God, Lord, our sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have created all that is and all that ever will be. Who are we as humanity that you should even care a moment for us, that you should give us the time of day to look at the beauty and the splendor of all that God has created, and then to look at ourselves and say, wow, who are we? Who is God? How did all of this around us come into being? What does this all mean? A lot of people, when they hear that word God, it might be capital G-O-D, it might be lowercase G-O-D, but it brings up all kinds of images. For some, a God is that statue there in a place of reverence where you offer coins and fruit and express reverence in order that the God might do something positive and beneficial within your life. For a lot of people, whether they have a relationship with God or not, God can be that great old man up there in the sky, the big man upstairs, that cantankerous individual who's always eager to knock us into shape when we mess up. For some people, God can be like Santa Claus, sweet and naive, always ready to give us what we want when we want it. For still other people, God is disconnected and disinterested with humanity and any of the affairs that unfold on this earth. And as I posed the question a few moments ago, for a growing population, the question is, what God? Who is this God? How dare you say that there's a God? Just a few years ago, the Pew Research Institute did a survey of about 5,000 Americans, and it was interesting the findings that came back from their research. The participants indicated that 9 out of 10 had some kind of belief in a deity or a supreme power. So that would be 90% of participants. But out of that 90% that looked at a belief in God as being something acceptable, only 56% claimed belief in what we call the God of the Bible. When further inquiry was done as to where some people doubted God, the 10%, or why there was such a significant percentage of those who do believe in God who have a different concept of God, these were the answers. When you see someone in the news who claims that God told them to do some heinous act against a group of people, a person's prayers for a sick loved one have gone unanswered. A dictator obliterates the lives of 6 million Jews during the Holocaust. Where is God then? It's understandable how people could look at the world and question things about who God is, does God exist, and if God exists, does God even care? We have our own beliefs about God because we assume God is supposed to work a certain way. God is supposed to act on our whims. God is supposed to move when we say move. And in response to that, author J.B. Phillips, a number of years ago, penned a book entitled, Your God is Too Small. And in that book, Phillips began to examine some of the issues that people were taking for the existence of God. Things like those statements I made just moments ago. And the gist of the book was just like the title says, your God is too small. So many people have an understanding of God that is minuscule. And when we cannot reconcile pain and suffering and problems in the world and make God fit what we think God ought to be doing in our lives, we start to question, is there a God. I pose that not just for those out there in the world who are identifying as atheist and agnostic in growing proportions, but even for us as Christians. Maybe Philip's question needs to resonate with us. Is our God too small? Is God the God we stick in the box on the shelf for convenience? Is God the one who is going to bring all things together at the end of time? Or for us as Christians, is God the living reality who is with us each and every day, as the psalmist acknowledged? When is the last time that you and I walked out and enjoyed God's creation? And looked at everything and said, wow, there's meaning, there's significance, there's purpose in all of this. There must be a God. To look up at the night sky that's not filtered by city lights, and to see the stars and the planets, and to think that you can't simply reach out and touch those stars and planets, but know that they are thousands upon thousands upon thousands of miles away. And to think about this planet that we live on called the Earth. And if you shifted its axis just a little bit one way or the other, it would throw everything out of kilter. If you moved planet Earth a fraction closer or farther away from the sun, we would either burn up or freeze to death. Why is that? How is that? And I'm sure there's a lot of people out there who want to explain it away and come up with all kinds of logic and so forth, but I have to believe there's a God. A God who is real, a God who acts, a God who makes God's self known each and every day. That reminds me of my first point. There's something working, someone working to make this life possible. Think about it. Look at your hand. Look at your fingerprints. Look at just your thumb. We have two thumbs. You multiply that by so many billion people on this planet, that's a lot of thumbs. But if you would fingerprint every one of those thumbs, every single one would be different. And I use that illustration because of something Sir Isaac Newton said long ago. If all I had was my thumb, that would be sufficient enough to prove the existence of God. And to know that God has designed our lives in such a way to make us unique. I think about the words of that great thinker, Aristotle, who said, it can't be by accident. There has to be an unmoved mover, to use his language, behind all that exists. One who cannot be moved, who's put everything into motion in the world as we know it today. The creation shouts the glory of God. And tells us that there is one who brings life and order into being. Now, even though David, as this psalm is attributed to David, doesn't go as far as the book of Exodus in its terminology, I can't help but think about how God revealed God's self to Moses through the burning bush. When Moses inquired, who is it that is sending me to lead the people out of Egyptian captivity? God said, I am that I am. God didn't say, my name is George or Elizabeth. God said, I am. God spoke not just a name, but also characteristics of who God is when he said, I am. I am existence itself. I am life beyond measure. I am is the one sending you, Moses, because I have fashioned you in my image. I have called and created this people who are now in captivity, and now I'm going to use them to make my name known to the world. The great I am, as we say. And I think about the words of a gospel song from some years ago that said simply, "The great I am still is." The psalmist expresses such confidence in God as creator and sovereign over all things, but then poses the question, who are we as human beings? Which brings me to my second point. My life, your life, is not the center of this universe. I'm sorry. I've tried it. I know a lot of people that do it every single day, but we're not the center of this world. The earth does not orbit around us. The sun and all the other planets and the galaxies do not base their existence upon us. We are who we are because of God. And I think back to those beautiful words found in Genesis chapter 1. Let us make humanity in our image. You see, we're not just created just to be, just to exist, just to pass, say, 100 years on this planet Earth. We are created in the image of God in order that we might make God known to the world. And to be created in the image of God means that we've been created to be creative. We've been created in order that we might love just as God loves. We've been created in order that we might change things within the world just as God longs to change things. We are God's representatives because God spoke everything into existence, breathed life into humanity, and said, "These people are going to represent me to the surrounding nations." Brothers and sisters, that's the God we serve. A God who is exalted above everything, as the psalmist says, but then at the same time, as Scripture reminds us, is as close as our best friend or a brother or sister. Who are we that God should be mindful of us, that God should create all of this amazing stuff, and then there's us, and we fall short of God's glory, and we miss the mark. And we mess up God's image within the world, but yet God still loves and cares for us deeply. And that brings me to my final point today. A belief in God calls each of us to live lives that are responsible. If God truly exists and God does truly matter in my life, then it will become evident to the world that is watching. If there's a God and God created everything, then I have a calling to look out for my neighbor. I've been given the responsibility to take care of this creation. Back in the beginning, God didn't call it good and say, "Okay, humanity, destroy it, throw it away, mess it up, abuse it as much as you want to." No, it tells us in the beginning that God gave humanity dominion, not domination, but responsibility to care for the created order. If God really exists and matters to me, and God loves humanity, then I have a responsibility to love other people who are also created in the same image of God as I am. If God is truly real, then we should long to see situations shaped for the better instead of adding to the stress, the strain, the brokenness of our society. If God is real, then we must learn to pay attention to things that matter most in life. When I say paying attention, I think about a visit this past week. Stopped by to see a gentleman, and I almost didn't go by there. I was busy, had a couple of things I really needed to take care of in the office. But something told me to turn down this particular road, and when I got there, I knocked on the back door, and then I opened the door, and I said, "Knock, knock, anybody home?" And I heard the man's voice say, "Preacher, just the man I wanted to see." He hadn't called me. I had to arrange that visit. Like I said, I was fixing to go straight to the church, hunker down in my office, knock out some work, but there was this prodding. There was this conviction on the inside that said, "Kelly, turn this way for a few minutes." Now, a lot of people would call that sheer coincidence, but I love the words of author Adam Hamilton. He doesn't call it coincidence. He calls it those moments God incidents. When God matters to me, I look up and I pay attention to something other than just me and myself and my longings and my personal desires. And it's my hope and my prayer, not just for my life, but as I close you with this thought, words taken from the great author Dietrich Bonhoeffer, may this be our longing every day that we live and we walk. Your life as a Christian should make non-believers question their disbelief in God. Is that so for us in our lives? May that be true for each of us. Thanks be unto God. Amen and amen. Our closing hymn is number 409. I know whom I have believed. This altar is open today, no matter the need, no matter the condition of your heart. If you've never trusted Jesus Christ to be your personal Savior and Lord, will you come today, as Scripture teaches us, can be your day of salvation? Maybe you would like to recommit your life to following Christ, to knowing what you believe and why you believe what you believe, and letting that be evident through who you are and who you're becoming every day. Maybe there are burdens that are weighing heavy upon your hearts and your minds, or even praise items you would like to come and celebrate with your Heavenly Father. No matter the need, God is present. Will we respond as God's Spirit is leading? Will you stand as we sing?
Wondrous grace, to thee be glory, 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 glory,
God's Spirit is continuing to move and people are continuing to pray. I'd ask my sister Terry McKeel to come and join me here at the front. And this is a little bit different kind of situation, but at the same time, very moving and meaningful for Terry and also for me as a pastor, because I don't know that I've ever presented someone in this way before a church body. Terry, of course, is a member of the Little Rock Church family, has been a number of years, well before I became the pastor. And she accepted Christ as Lord and Savior long before that as well. But today she wants to come on recommitment of her faith. She's been learning and studying and growing in Christ. And now she really, truly wants to be the person that God has called her to be. I'm not asking for you to vote her back into the church or anything along those lines. But if you will promise to encourage her and love her and support her as she continues this journey of faith and growth, as we all do, if you'll commit to supporting her in that, will you give a loud amen on a count of three? One, two, three. Amen. Amen indeed. And I think that sounds like a pretty good affirmation from the body of Christ at Little Rock.
And I'm not going to forget it.
When we say that, we should truly mean it, because we're in this journey together. We lean on each other for comfort and support, not just when life is difficult or there's tragedy, but as we seek to become who God wants us to be, we remind each other that we're not alone. We're still growing together. We're going to stumble sometimes, but God is willing to forgive us and give us those second chances. For this decision, even though it's not a new profession of faith, I'm still going to ask you to join me in the narthex so that people can offer that hand of support and encouragement for this step in your faith journey. Brothers and sisters, it's been good to be with you today in the house of our Savior and Lord. As we leave this place, may we seek to embody God in both word and deed to whomever we meet, wherever God should take us in the days to come. Would you bow with me for our benediction and the blessing of today's offering? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time of worship where we've been able to encounter your power and presence. Lord, fill us with your Spirit and enable us to live out our faith commitment everywhere that we go, every day that we live. As the Scriptures remind us, it's in you that we live and move and have our existence, and that should be evident to the watching world around us, a place where people question your very existence. Lord, in the words of Bonhoeffer, may our lifestyle cause people to question their doubts about you. Lord, I ask that you would bless these tithes and offerings that we're about to receive and multiply them to the ongoing ministry of your kingdom. And now receive this blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace both now and forevermore. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and together God's people said, Amen. Amen.